is my great pleasure to be introducing the keynote for today. I want to give a brief bio of each of our participants in today's keynote, but I want to preface it by saying that I first met Charisse Harrison Nelson and Donald Harrison in 1993 when I was working with Junebug Productions on its environmental justice project, which commissioned 9 new pieces of art through collaborations with artists, local and national, and community organizations. And I have had the privilege of working with Charisse and on and off in different occasions with Donald ever since. And they are truly New Orleans treasures and an important part of our local community. Donald Harrison Jr. is a musical force of nature. A New Orleans native son, Harrison describes himself as a jazz saxophonist, band leader, composer, cultural participant, singer, actor, master costume maker, custom furniture designer and builder, inventor and educator. He co-founded and continues to direct Tipitina's intern program and has appeared in several national films, including HBO's Tremé and Spike Lee's documentary, When the Levees Broke. Harrison has received awards in France, Switzerland, and Japan, and here in the United States for both his music and his civic efforts. He performed with the Grammys on the road at the Detroit Jazz Festival, and his group, Donald Harrison Electric Band, frequently appears in the top 10 of Billboard magazine with their popular radio hits. He is widely known for combining jazz with Afro-New Orleans traditional music. You can hear for yourself on the 20-plus albums he has recorded. Harrison is the big chief of the Congo Nation Afro-New Orleans Cultural Group, which keeps alive the traditions of Congo Square. Charisse Harrison Nelson is an educator, artist, and third-generation Mardi Gras Indian with a passion for children and a deep commitment to the authentic expression of cultural heritage. She holds an MA in education and postgraduate training in cultural anthropology, and has produced documentaries and extensive educational materials about the Mardi Gras Indian traditions. She is the queen of the Guardians of the Flame and curator of the Mardi Gras Indian Hall of Fame. Her original beaded creations are held in the private collections of Academy Award-winning director Jonathan Demme, Nobel Prize in Literature laureate Wally Soyinka, HBO's Tremé creators David Simon and Eric Overmeyer, former Mayor Mark Morial of New Orleans, and Mrs. Ed Bradley. Charisse has performed and lectured extensively throughout the world during the past 20 years, notably in the United Arab Emirates on a State Department tour. She is a recipient of the Fulbright Scholarship, the Mayor's Arts Award, Louisiana Endowment for the Humanities Teacher of the Year Award, among others. And the Mardi Gras Indian Hall of Fame, which Charisse curates and directs, is a member of New Orleans, of NPN's local network here. Gwen Tompkins is a freelance journalist and writer in New Orleans and host of the weekly hour-long public radio program, Music Inside and Out, where she presents the standard bearers of Louisiana culture, a stunning array of musicians, songwriters, producers, engineers, music writers, most often recorded in their own studios, as they talk about the art of making music and the songs that influence them. Tompkins began her career in New Orleans at the Times-Picayune newspaper and then moved to National Public Radio, where she worked as senior editor of Weekend Edition Saturday and as NPR's East African Bureau Chief. She returned to New Orleans in 2011 after serving a fellowship at Harvard University in journalism. Gwen's Music Inside Out is also a member of NPN's local network. And I must say, she and I share the proud opportunity of being alumna of Ursuline Academy here in New Orleans. So please welcome Gwen Tompkins, and she will kick us off.
Thank you so much. It It's wonderful to be here today, actually, and I've been looking forward to it for some time. And so I'm thrilled to be on the stage with these wonderful people. Hello. But what I think everyone in this room can relate to is the fact that nothing ever goes exactly the way you plan it to go, even though, of course, the MPN has done a wonderful job and will continue to do a wonderful job, of course. But in my scramble to come here, I actually mislaid my introduction. And so now I'm actually thinking about this really historic moment that almost went unnoticed. Years ago, when Bill Clinton was president, he gave a State of the Union address. And you know that the stakes are very high for the State of the Union addresses, you know, because you got to make it look like your team's doing well. And Mr. Clinton goes on stage. Of course, the whole world is looking. And then, in the middle of his speech, the prompter goes out. And then he just keeps talking. And he talks for 18 minutes. Without notes, without a prompter. And he's always, to me, been the ideal of, making it work. Just making it work, you know? So the thing is, I actually have some help from my friends here who very kindly, and of course, technology, because I got my sister to email everything to me. And so now we're going to thank Apple, and we're going to thank my sister, who's visiting from Italy, actually, and we will begin. Jazz pierced the air. And some people will tell you, oh, it was Buddy Bolden. You know, Buddy Bolden did that thing on the cornet and it was fabulous, you know? And then other people, well, will say, and the first person would say, it was Jelly Roll Morton when he talked to Alan Lomax, and he said, no, I was the first person, the very first person who ever put fingers to piano keys and made jazz. But the truth of the matter is that anybody who has a heart is going to thank Louis Armstrong, because without Louis Armstrong, not one person would be in this room today. But the thing is, you know, jazz is only part of the musical story and evolution of New Orleans. In fact, it's only the middle of the story, because the truth of the matter is the beginning of the story, first of all, it starts in other continents, you know, in New Orleans, the beginning of the story begins in the late 1850s with the French Opera House being built. It's the first opera house in all of North America. And of course, more than 100 years before that, okay, you know, our musical history begins with the slaves, of Louisiana, who are going every Sunday to Congo Square to make a percussive heaven. And so when you put those two things together, just like Reese's peanut butter cups, you know, you got your chocolate, you got your peanut butter, and it makes magic. And I can attest to that. I have sampled it quite often. But the thing is, if you want, but the truth is, music, the story of music continued well after Louis Armstrong left here for good. And and the people who have represented that story have been Professor Longhair, they've been Fats Domino, there are Alan Toussaint, who's still working today, they are, believe it or not, Lil Wayne and Big Frida. Isn't that funny, Lil Wayne and Big Frida? but they're all big in our eyes. And there is no family that better represents the story of the evolution of New Orleans music than the Harrisons. I mean, the Harrisons are the land of clans, and we are all musical clans, here. You know what I mean? The Harrison sword reigned supreme in large part because, you know, in one family you have these educators, you have folklorists, you have, you know, chiefs, you know, you've got a queen. I mean, you know, that's pretty great. And so I'm just thrilled that we are here today and that we can talk about this story, you know? And so would you mind picking up your microphones? Yes, yeah, sure.
It's a private joke.
and we can actually begin. And what I want to know the first thing that I would like to talk with you all about is a little bit about your father, you know, Donald Harrison Sr., who of course was a big chief of Guardians of the Flame, that wonderful Mardi Gras tribe. And I want to ask you first, I mean, when you are the children of a big chief, does that automatically make you a prince and a princess, or what does that make you?
Makes you his daughter. That's what it makes you.
Yeah.
For me, as a child, I didn't really understand the whole Mardi Gras Indian thing. If you're born into something, you don't understand that it's different. You think it's like that at everybody's house. You mean people don't come to your house and play tambourines and sing? You don't have that at your house? But for me, my father was my daddy. And of course, my memories of him are the memories that any child would probably have with their daddy. He shared his love of music with us. He also shared his sense of justice, fairness, and to have compassion and to try to be a good human being. And to be honest, if you did it, own it. If you couldn't own it, don't do it. So my father was very honest, as my mother will always say. And sometimes the truth may have hurt you, but he wasn't going to lie to you. He wasn't going to candy coat it.
And so Donald Harrison Jr., can you talk a little bit about the experience of being the son of a big chief?
Well, I know it was, I remember being the little chief of the Creole Wild West, I think 2 years old. I don't know, because I just remember seeing guys in feathers moving so fast, going back and forth. So, you know, these vague memories that go inside of you. And the other part is my mother says I used to play drums on the crib. So those rhythms, which inform everything that I do nowadays, I always loved rhythm.
Yes.
Even, you know, I always remember playing on the doors around the house. And I really should have been a drummer.
But that's another story entirely.
Yes, that's another story. I go on segues. But anyway, it's just that he knew a lot about a lot of different subjects. My parents made sure that we looked into, had access to many things, culture, politics, and just the world in general.
I want to talk about that actually, because, I mean, first of all, and I ask this question to almost all musicians I speak to, because it's very important. Even if your answer doesn't seem logical. But tell me what your childhood sounded like. Tell me what your house sounded like. What was playing?
Everything.
Like what?
Like Etta James, the UNESCO series, Ravi Shankar, The Sound of Music, Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie, Madrigal Singers, Bach and Beethoven, just, you know, music. I remember talking about UNESCO series, South African pygmy music, and I heard that a lot, and then when Herbie Hancock made a song called Watermelon Man, Bill Summers was playing this line that I heard on from the Pygmy music from South Africa.
Really?
So it made me have, because I paid attention, I'm like a detailed kind of guy. I pay attention to and remember exactly what people were doing. So when I heard that, I said, oh, that came from there. So all of these different sounds that I was hearing my whole life became lodged in my memory banks. And so I think of music not as one entity, but as a broad spectrum.
Exactly. And so Charisse, can you fill in the picture? We've heard some of the artists and some of the pieces of music that you all were listening to as kids. What else were you listening to? I hate to put you on the spot, but around what time are we talking? Was it the 60s?
The 60s, 70s? The early 60s, well, as long as I can remember. So it would be the early 60s. And for me, I'm not a musician, I'm not an expert. I guess my memories are very in my heart kind of memories. And I remember the music that Donald was talking about. I guess that was the same music. It was some records my dad had of African rhythms. And in third grade, we had to write an essay on if you could take the vacation that you really wanted to take, the ideal vacation, where would you want to go? And it may be hard to believe, but I've always been a little different. So everyone wanted to go to Disneyland. And I said, because I was only 8 years old at that time in Mrs. Calamari's class, I wanted to go to Africa. And I wanted to see drummers, and I would have a dream. I always had this dream where I was looking through flats. I mean, on grass. I was looking through grass and I saw an orchestra of drummers in a circle and they had on white clothing. And I had the opportunity to go to West Africa under Dr. Ekajuru in 1994, I think, to study. And I saw that.
Wow.
I saw that. We were in the mountains in Ghana and it wasn't grass, but it was a church in the mountains. And they had I don't know a lot about this either, some wood slats. I think it was like a fence, but it wasn't a fence. But as I looked through it, it was my dream that I had been having since I was 8 years old. It was as though my dad sent me there so that I could experience that in another way. And I always say that trip unlocked my feet. I never felt very comfortable in my body. I never was very comfortable, but my daddy has done things and he still visits me and he still unlocks the true Charisse. I never wore red. Whenever you see me with red on, it is an homage to my daddy because he told me, you are a queen. You look good in that red. So I may not look good in the red, but I look good to my daddy in the red. So I wear red. And when we were children, one of my fondest memories, and it just shows how things go full circle, was when we were children, and I don't know if Don remembers this because I'm the oldest, but my father would sit us on the sofa, and there's four of us, and we're stair steps, and my mother would have some me time, I guess, to like just take a bath and go, I don't have to be with four children. He would get us to sit there by playing like a Gil Evans album, but then he would tell us, because we all love this record, Salt Peanuts by Dizzy Gillespie, that it would come on. But we had, because, you know, you little children, you think it's magic that music comes out of this box. And he would say, if you just sit there, I promise you, your record is going to come on, and then you can sing. So we would sit for a whole album, hey. And then he would put Salt Peanuts on. I don't know why we didn't realize, like, he got up and put the song on. And then he would say, okay, your record is on, and we would sit there and wait, and we would go, Salt Peanuts. And then he put Miles Davis on, listen to it for 30 minutes, and then he put Dizzy Gillespie on, and we go, Salt Peanuts. So we might sit there for 2 hours listening to jazz, young children, like 5, 6, 7 years old. And the beauty of that is, as a third grade teacher, and at Haley School, formerly Garay, Donald actually came and shared that with the students at the school. So we had a whole generation. We had 800 children at Haley School that would go around the school saying, Salt Peanuts, Salt Peanuts.
But the Mardi Gras Indian tradition, in terms of music, is also it also has its secrets, you know, that can be kind of difficult to discern. So for instance, I've lived my entire life as a New Orleanian, never quite knowing what terms like Hudatne or Giacomo Finane actually mean. I mean, they mean something to me, you know what I mean, based on my own experience. I once told Alan Toussaint, well, you know, I have Mighty Putafayo. I had no idea what I was talking about, but I, you know what I mean, but it sounded good. And right. I really felt like I had it, even though I really don't know what it is exactly. And so, was that at all explained to you all in the house? I mean, did you all, how did you, you know, you come up against these songs, and I mean, how did you come to understand them?
Yeah, I was told what some of the words mean, a lot of them, and I endeavor to keep them. And the pronunciation, the correct pronunciation.
You speak with an accent.
No, not in that culture, maybe. Maybe, well, from the, there's different factions, but from the faction that I came from, I feel that I have good enunciation in terms of being able to say those words and understanding the context of what they mean. But you know what, what's the reason I think that it has to be kept the way it is as an entity that no one on the outside really understands is because if you look at the history of the world, every time an outsider comes in, the first thing they do is to try to take over. And the next thing they do is to tell the people that are actually keeping it alive and who are the expert of it, of that, that they don't know what they're doing. So it has to, one of the only things in the history of America that has been kept in sort of a pristine state inside of America. So I think those gentlemen deserve a round of applause for just being able to keep something alive in the traditional fashion without someone coming telling them, you don't know what you're doing and we're gonna make it better for you. No, it's already better, leave it alone.
And so, but the thing is, how old is this tradition?
Well, it's historical accounts from the 1700s. So. But it's tied to the ancient. So, you know. From the beginning.
I love that. Yeah. And so I want you, I mean, you all, I'm sure, have heard this a million times, but I haven't, and so I got the microphone, so I'm gonna do it. But I'd like you all to hear a little bit of, from your, this was an album that you did called Indian Blues, which you actually hipped me to. This was an album that featured a wonderful mashup between the Indian, Mardi Gras Indian musical tradition and jazz, and it included, you know, a man who we've just been talking about, Donald Harold Harrison Sr. And I just want you all to hear this man's voice, because you're hearing, you know, what you're hearing as the children are telling you today is something that really harkens back to the 1700s, right? So with that kind of build up, we'll see what we got.
Thank you.
I feel his spirit, the spirit of a strong man who wanted to share his authentic self with the world. And I also feel the responsibility of carrying his legacy on in my way. And he was a spirit-filled man. And as I just referenced, I may not be an expert on anything, but I am an expert on the way I feel in my heart.
Yes. Yes.
And that is my guiding principle. All of my work is based on providing and sharing and giving to the world what I want for those who share my DNA. And when I do that, I have done my very best. It may not be anyone else's best, but it is my best. Every child I encounter, I teach them the way I want my son taught, or my niece, or my future grandchildren who are not born yet. And that's what I try to let my dad come through that work. A spirit of truth, a spirit of authenticity, and a spirit of love. I have been in some very dark places emotionally. But I always say, you know, if you look through a skeleton keyhole and the light that comes through, you can, on one side there's a lot of light, and on the other side, it's just a little sliver of light. But sometimes I'm on the side with all of the light when I'm around the children, and other times I'm on the other side where it's very dark and you have to get, and this, my daddy and my mom gave me the will to find that little sliver of light and get there and dance and sing and reflect and to find how to be happy and how to let my light shine and to shine a light on children and others who desire to learn about or be a part of, whether it's direct involvement or just to be on the fringe of it, just to experience the joy. And that is my path in life. That is what my daddy gave me, and that is what my mother gave me, how to be happy, share happiness, and how to be authentic.
And so Donald, what do you hear when you hear that record? I mean, obviously it's your record. You've heard it a million times.
I've heard it a million times. No, but that record came about because I was, being a jazz musician, I was in a place where my career wasn't doing well, and my father was starting to go into the flames, so I came home to be with him and to get some more of that information and that joy from him. And in the middle of that, if you understand music, if you listen to the ride pattern that the drummer is playing, while we were out Mardi Gras Day, I began to hear that the rhythms of Duke Ellington and Art Blakey and all the jazz rhythms were really the same as the music that we were playing with my father with the drum beats. So the drummer is playing a mixture of what we played in New York, modern jazz, and what we do here in New Orleans. So it put me on a quest to really find out. I guess I was sort of born to understand rhythm, to put these pieces together, because it's the path of my life. And the fact that I really pay attention to everything. You know, I can remember how a guy played tambourine in the 60s. It's something that I just automatically was drawn to and just really paid attention to and tried to understand. So all these little disparate pieces of music came together in my head. And he came and he, of course, did what he does. And that is, like my sister said, bring the spirit to the music. And I'm so happy that I had a chance to make a recording with him. And sometimes, I mean, I love all music, but I consider myself a serious musician at that. Serious musicians, the ideal is to be the best you can be. and to move the genre to, and everything, the world, to a better and higher state, and to keep pushing the envelope, and to know as much as you can know, and to not be afraid of knowledge, to use it to help and further. And so I feel like we sort of bridged the gap of that of spirituality. What I like to think of it as mind, body, and soul. All of it, the whole picture. But you have to do your work. You have to use your mind at all times. And I think that we find that it automatically will make you move, but it's also deep intellectually, hopefully, from my perspective, and hopefully from others who listen to it. And it's, for me, it started my mind to thinking in a different way, and it has led me to find, I know I found a key to the next step of how, the way they, I put it like this, the way they explain music is not what it really is. Going to all these different places and seriously having respect for all these other musicians. I think my father taught me to have respect for other people and to try to understand what they were doing and to take time to really listen to it, because we would really sit down and listen to things, and he would explain, this is Trading Fours, this is the drummer. He took time to do that. And I paid attention. It just didn't go through one ear and it stopped in the middle. And so I paid attention to doing this and thinking like that. And now I know for sure that the explanation for what music is not correct.
That's true. You know, it's funny you should say that, because what both of you all are talking about is a universality of experience that's expressed through music. And I don't think I've ever met a musician who said differently. And what they say is essentially, and I'm thinking that you all might agree, is that the idea that there are divisions between music, that there's jazz, that there's R&B, that there's, you know, early R&B, that there's whatever, bounce, you know, these are all false categories, you know, and that music is what it is. And that it's all interrelated.
It's all interrelated, but there's definitely different styles of music. Mm-hmm. And music also has different ideals. But like I said, the ideal of jazz is to understand as much as you can understand and be able to tell the story from your experience and then respecting the other guy's ideas and learning from them. But you know, you spoke a little Wayne, I don't think that's the ideal of
it's certainly not the ideal of dentistry, I can tell you that.
And, so, it just depends on what the artist is trying to portray and his heart and spirit. And it will, you know, because I've heard themes of in hip hop, I'm better than you, I got more money than you. So that's a little different theme. But I've also heard themes of uplifting what we call conscious rap. So there's different ways of dealing with everything. And you can have blues or jazz that is what they call race music a long time ago, where you would talk about the same kind of things maybe rappers would talk about. So it just depends on what the artist wants to give with their music. So it doesn't, but there's different, when you play a swing beat, they're all interrelated, but when you play with someone like Art Blakey, it's gonna be difficult for a guy who plays R&B to come up there and really deal with it. And it's gonna be difficult for a guy from Cuba to come into the R&B world and really speak that language. I think of music like languages. You have to go in and learn how to speak this language. And then when I come back to jazz, I can add from my experience what connects the two music and what keeps it. Like on that record, I would imagine that someone in the culture of New Orleans still could get up and feel like they could dance to that.
Yeah.
Well, the jazz person could also say that's jazz. So to bridge the gap, you know, to find the element that keeps it authentic for someone playing down here and someone playing in New York.
Exactly.
And that takes a lot of hard work. And that's the key to it is hard work. What are you willing to sacrifice? Do you believe that you have it inside? Because you when you're really trying to learn something and put it together, you have to sacrifice. I had to sacrifice a lot to make the choices. Oh, if you come over here, you can work with the movie people. No, I don't want to do that. I want my music to be real. And then once the music is real, maybe I'll go do that later. Yeah. So I made choices.
Yeah. And so Sharice,
I just wanted to add that one last thing about my father. He did a wonderful job on Indian Blues with my brother. I simply love my father's rendition of Shallow Water on that. It almost makes me cry every time I hear it. I can listen to it 50 times in a row, literally. But what I want to say is that, of course, I knew nothing about making a CD or a record, but I decided I wanted to make one. Donald was very supportive. It was a family effort. And my father, what I loved about it, it was made on a shoestring budget, literally. I would be in the studio saying, okay, that's all the money in my savings account. We have to stop at 4 o'clock. That's the way the CD was made. And then when we got my income tax check, okay, we can go in for 3 hours. It took a year to make it. We started on January 1st and we ended on November 1st, almost a year. But one of the songs, two things, my father made sure that my nephews and my son could sing a traditional Mardi Gras Indian chant, and they each sang one on the song. And they were teenagers when we made this. They were very young, and it was part of that environmental justice project, actually. And the themes are about environmental justice, but we added some other things in, and one of the songs we added in was Chong Chong. And I just remember my father was at the end of his life then, how he went into the den and he worked with my nephews and he worked with my son to make sure they could sing this song from the 1920s. And when we were in the studio, he wanted the engineer to understand, and so he gave this explanation. This song is from the 1920s. It's actually on the CD. And that was his spirit to make sure, but he also gave the children his blessing to go on and expand. And they did a hip hop song under Donald's direction, Big Easy Party, but he wanted them to be rooted. Yeah. To be rooted. You have to be rooted before you can go to the next level. And it's not anything like on the level of Indian Blues, but it's just the spirit, his spirit, and his support of me as a female who knew nothing about anything, but just wanted to make a record.
Well, I tell you, you know, you say you like Shallow Water. I mean, I do have it here.
I love it.
Would you mind hearing it? Because I love it too, and, you know, any excuse I have to.
And he calls out the names of some of the ancestors that have gone on, and it's just beautiful.
I'm
that song is just really telling a wonderful story.
What does it tell? What's the story?
He's talking about the strength of his group, nobody kneel, nobody bow. And then he's saying, he's calling, acknowledging the ancestors. Bernard's gone all day long. Bernard Lomax was the person that, I don't want to use the wrong music word, but he composed, he originated the response. But the call, my father's telling a story about his gang and how strong they are and not to remember. And he just calls the names, and we have to do that. We have to call the names, because if not, we become monolithic individuals, and we're not. And so I just bow down to that, and I'm so glad he gave that to me.
And so Donald Harrison Jr., you said something very interesting the other day to me in our very first conversation, and that was that you can't teach something unless you've lived it. And you know, that brought up so many images to me, one of them being actually a Louis Armstrong image, because he was the one who said, you know, one of the reasons why he was such an acolyte of King Oliver was that King Oliver, above all the other musicians living in New Orleans at the time, would actually stop to help children learn how to play their instruments. And Armstrong said, well, if ever I had a question, you know, Oliver would stop in his tracks and show me how to do what I need to do on the clarinet and the trumpet. And all. And so a lot of what you and your sister have done in your adult lives is to try to educate, and you know, kids as to the tradition of New Orleans music, and you know, and to think about music and play music, and you know, in a way that's authentic to themselves. How do you start? Yeah, how do you start? How do you know A, that you know enough to teach somebody something, and then B, where do you start?
Well, for people, you know, first thing I ask students is what they want to do. And if I feel like I'm qualified, then I will help them go in that direction. But in the meantime, I start teaching them things that I know and to broaden their scope of music.
Like what?
Well, I'm a jazz musician. I realize that for me, well, I think in my head, from playing so many different types of music, that bebop is the key to everything.
Bebop is the key to everything.
Yeah, because in American music, maybe not for classical music, but Charlie Parker is the same as Bach was for classical music.
And that
when Bach made the well-tempered clavier, he found the key for the way the music would be played after that, and everything is based upon his revelation with a well-tempered clavier. So when Bird came along, he did the same thing. And I always remember Dizzy Gillespie's statement, which I don't think is correct, but I'll live with it. He said, when I heard Charlie Parker, I said to myself, that is the way our music should go. No, not our music, Charlie Parker's. You can follow Charlie Parker, let's tell the truth. But he joined Charlie Parker, and Charlie had put all of these disparate ideas together and came up with a way that harmony and rhythm and melodic line would be shaped if you were going to play modern jazz from a traditional perspective. So I try to share. I spent 15 years trying to understand bebop, and I blame it on my father too, because he put on Charlie Parker and told me, now play this. And I couldn't play the first three notes, and I knew he had put me in a trick bag. I fell in love with this guy and wanted to, that's what I'm saying about making choices. I made the choice to be around the guys who could play bebop, who played with Charlie Parker, and stay in their bands to really learn it. I really like to know exactly what's going on. I remember I used to play with Art Blakey.
And the Jazz Messengers.
So every night I would get on his drum, I would look at him and try to steal what he was doing, go on a drum set and blah, 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 playing it. And then Art would look at me like, what's wrong with this boy? After about a month of me doing that every night, he said, "You're doing it all wrong."
Really?
And he started showing me his, what in drums they call a sticking, the exact way he was doing things. And it's just my need to know in those. I find that a lot of the masters, I guess the word is out on me. And so they really try to show me exactly how they're doing things. Because I want to know something. From all these different experiences, over 30 years of guys showing me how the music is put together and playing with them on a bandstand every night, these are ideas. I don't feel like I'm teaching, I just feel like I'm sharing ideas that were given to me by great masters like Miles Davis and Lena Horne and Art Blakey and Roy Haynes, Ron Cocker, the list goes on.
It's true. But the thing is, on the other hand, and I don't think New Orleans is that much different from any other town in the country, you know, it can be very difficult to communicate to young people, and I don't mean to bash young people, you know, but, you know, I mean, the import of what you're saying. I once talked to a kid who lives next door to Professor Longhair's house on Terpsichore Street here in New Orleans, and I said, "Do you know who used to live in that house?" And he goes, "Oh, that's Longhair's house. I don't know his music. That's my grandmother's music." Okay, next door. I could have killed that kid, right? You know, or I have friends who say, like, when I say, "Oh, when I want to turn on jazz," they go, "You know, jazz is like..." You know, they're like, you know, "We don't want to hear that." You know, so how do you find the bridge?
There's nothing I really have to do with it, except once it gets into their heart and their spirit, then they want to know it. And then we work together on music. Because young people have ideas too, and I listen to them and talk to them about what they're trying to do. But I'm able to pass on, you know, the information that was given to me. I remember one time, my bass player, he's sitting over there, we were, and I used to tell them, "You know, I'm just sharing it," because sometimes they would look at me like, "What are you talking about?" I said, "Well, I'm just telling you what they told me." So we were in Europe somewhere, and I was sitting with a great saxophone player, Charles Lloyd, and he pulled me on and said, "Come here, Harrison." And he started just talking and telling me all this stuff. And I said, "Hold on, Charles. Can I get my two musicians so that they will know that when I say I'm just telling you what these guys told me, that I'm not lying?" So I called him over and he said, "Yeah, Harrison's going to pass it on." If you remember, that's what he said. "Pass it on. Harrison's going to pass it on."
Yeah.
So now, besides what I'm doing with the culture here, it's all these musicians from all these different types of music. I guess that's my father's spirit in me, because he said that the old chiefs groomed him. So maybe these musicians see the same thing in me that those old chiefs saw in my father, that they want to take me on the side, pull me by the collar, "Come here." I remember I met Count Basie when I was 19, and he kept me the whole day. I was trying to get away. He was like, "Come here, boy." So much information is just impossible to even remember. But,
you know, any story that begins "Count Basie when I was 19" is a good story. You know? But Charisse, you know, Harrison Nelson, you catch the kids even earlier. I mean, what Don was talking about is dealing with kids whose hearts are already open to the experience. You know what I mean? You're talking to kids who are in the community, third grade, as you mentioned earlier, and you know what I mean, and throughout elementary and middle school. And so, how do you soften their hearts?
Well, I know my mother's here. Raise your hand, Mama. Any story that starts with "when my mama used to" is also a good story. My mama used to have a daycare center, nursery school. And so the student population was actually babies and toddlers. I guess from maybe 9 months to 4 years old or 5 years old. And during that time, she actually played jazz music for the children and also show tunes, because for some reason my mother liked show tunes. Understand why these young African American children were going around singing show tunes.
I am 60.
And humming the Nutcracker. Anyway, that's the kind of stuff she played for, the music she played for young children. So, of course, I went through my whole stage in college that I didn't want to be a teacher. I don't want to work with children. That's hard. I'm going to do something else. I took classes in every department. Well, guess what? Anyway, I was a third grade teacher. But I knew from that, those experiences, when I wanted to give something to my student, that we could play jazz during times when they were having reflective writing or reflective thinking, and that was also music that they could identify with. So of course I shared the music that I liked when I was a child. Miles Davis, So What? Because it has a little attitude, as my daddy would say, you can say, So What? And, you know, Salt Peanuts, and other songs, compositions that I enjoyed with the children. And so we had a Jazz Awareness Month program where we would bring artists in and share that music with the children, hoping that it would not develop a jazz audience, but also children who wanted to play music would know that there were other types of music out there rather than the music that they only heard on the popular radio. So that is what we have done, to add depth and breadth to children's learning experiences using jazz music. And they love it, they really like it.
I just want to add, you know, one key element that we're forgetting is the guys who work with me, the younger musicians, they're going to be doing the same thing. So that's the key is, like Charles Lloyd said, pass it on. So I'm getting it from the horse's mouth, and they're getting some of it second generation, but they're still able to pass it on and keep a connection to, as my sister said, the roots. It all goes back to the roots. A tree can't grow without strong roots, and you can't build any house without a strong foundation. That's gonna last. So this is the principle of what we're talking about, to go in and get a strong foundation and then build as you may on top of that.
Well, let me ask you this. Because we don't really have a whole lot of time left, but I do want to understand the learning process, you know, because hopefully, you know, we'll all be able to communicate something from this conversation to somebody who really needs to hear about it. And so can you talk, you know, I'd like to invite some of your musicians up, actually, and who will be very kind enough to demonstrate some of your thoughts. And so can you introduce them for us, please?
Yeah, we have Max Moran. He's usually a bassist, but today he's a cowbell player. And we have another chief of New Orleans culture, Shaka Zulu. He's a great bassist. He has the Golden Feather restaurant. Yeah. And I want to plug my mother's museum, the Donald Harrison Senior Museum. She has, if you want to see those suits, she has some suits up also. But it'll be nice to go visit her place if she has some time to open it up for you. She's holding the fort down. She's the only museum and foundation in the Ninth Ward that is done by a participant. Well, she's not a participant, it's being in the tribe, but she supported so many people by making the suits, helping me to make my suits, my father. And she's a cultural bearer. Without her, as you know, there would be none of us. So give her a round of applause.
I just want to add one thing about my mother, and it will be quick. Because I'm very proud of this fact. We had the, yesterday was one of my happiest days. I was on the other side with the light. We went to a mobile school and the children had lunch at Basin Street Station, which is a very nice venue. But she has reached the benchmark of giving over 34,000 new books together, we have together, to children in the New Orleans public schools, free of charge, with a musical presentation, and the books are valued at, conservatively, over $400,000. One woman's dream, I just support it.
And so let me ask you this, and if you can start us off slowly, and because when we hear this fabulous music that you do, and that you know your whole family has participated in, it's a fait accompli, and it sounds so rich that that for the newcomer, it's as if you're thinking, well, I can never do that. How does it? Can you start us off slowly and show us how it builds to what we've been hearing, what you do?
Well, it's you have to be able to do it like with anything. You have to come inside, and then you have to show. With this, you have to show that you should be inside. So you have to make, I'll put it like this. One time I was working with this guy, Jim Peel in New York, and he was, we were doing a record. We're co-writing a CD of Brazilian music, which I feel comfortable doing. And Jim Peel hires musicians for the Grammys and for all these big TV shows. But to play the saxophone, you have to, on those TV shows, you have to play flute and bassoon and English horn, what they call doubling. So Jim said, man, I want to get you on these TV shows. You can play on the Grammys, you can play on the Oscars, and because you're my guy. I said, well, you know, Jim, I don't really play those instruments. And there's a guy somewhere, and he does that. And he's been working his whole life to be on the Grammys, to play those TV shows. So don't get me, because I'm not the guy. I don't deserve to do that. And I don't want to focus on that because I'm a progressive musician. Let me focus on that. So we all have a job to do. And we need to accept, you know, you'll feel it when you're supposed to do it. And that's what I'm saying. You'll feel it. That's all it is, just feel it. If you know it's in your heart to do it, do it. If it ain't, let the next guy do it and you do your thing, so on. Everybody's got a job to do. Accept it and love it. You know, I knew that there was a guy who should be doing that, and it wasn't me. So that's good. I'll put it like that. We're gonna do it like this. Gucci Mane! Hey, Pinky, you're kind of a square nation. And on Mardi Gras Day, I cause a sensation. I make blue do it, buddy, bambo, all in that morning. I go to St. Louis Cemetery, wake up the dead, kick over tombstones, and make a hoomba. In the middle of a hurricane, I made the sun come out. When I talk, nothing but thunder, lightning come out my mouth. Took a tiger by the tail, the lion tooth, through the jungle, would not go through. Early that morning, early that day, said Giacomo, feel him a who not rep. I'm a real big chief, away up top. Put a hole in the ground, make them dance all around. Go down on the bayou, shoot that fire. Down on the river, stand in the liver. Here come the boys with a heart of steel. Would not bow, they would not kneel. Shabba! We're gonna take them down to the way cocky way. The way cocky way. The way cocky way. Early in the morning. One by one.
they wanted, one by one. They were the, do you like you wanna, well then they wanna. And I'm from now, nobody wants.
As we said, my father was made an indelible impression on all of us and on our lives. And I'm going to tell you a story. It's an emotional story, but to me it has a happy ending. On December 1st, 1998, was the saddest day of my life. It is the day my daddy became an ancestor. I went to work, and you know how it is when you just know the day something isn't right. My mother called and said, the hospital had called and I hurried up to the hospital because my daddy wasn't looking good. I did that. I walked into the room. Well, when I walked down the corridor, the nurse said, hurry up, your daddy's dying. I walked into the room, and my father was not very responsive. I was there by myself for what seemed like an eternity, but it was only a few minutes. I went to the bed, and I said, Daddy, please don't leave us. Daddy, don't do this. Please, Daddy, don't do this. We're not ready for you to go. Stop it. After a while, my mother came into the room and she said, you need to stop. Look at your father. I looked at my daddy and tears were rolling from his eyes. Wow. He was trying to talk. She said, let your daddy go. It's time for him to go. He can't go if he doesn't know you're gonna be okay. So the CD that we had in production, I put it in, and all the songs played. And the song that my sister sang on came on. And as my daddy left, we sang that song along with him. And he always talked about eagles being majestic birds, and he beat it blue eagles. There are really no bright blue eagles in nature that we know of. But it was a symbol. Number one, my mother's favorite color is blue. It's a beautiful color, and it's also a symbol of strength and majesty. And that day, he flew away. And I, you know, we all struggle with things. And in, I always say my private head movies. And in my private head movie, I just sang him away. Yeah. I rearranged a traditional song, yeah. And there's a song in our tradition where you sing the first verse, you hum the second verse, and then you sing it spirited. Now, I am not a musician, But this is what I sang to my daddy in my head. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, bye-bye, I'll fly away.
So just remember that, and remember we're all part of the story, and now you're part of the story. And so I'd like to thank Sharice Harrison Nelson for and I'd also like to thank Donald Harrison Jr.
Play some jazz now, and I hope my father will be happy now to hear me play some of the ideas that I learned from Charlie Parker and put on my context now. He was the one that told me Charlie Parker's music was hard, and he was right. So, and he was the one who bought me a saxophone without me asking for one. So, this is a little song called Misty.
Thank you.
little boy with the money on my mama, good night again. Say, Yakima, from the moon, my way, good night again. I'm gonna have my fun on a holiday, good night again. And come on. I got mine, good night today. She remembered me more than a better term, good night today. So we had that one, so we had our one, good night today.
What I most appreciated about him is that regardless of who he was working with, regardless of what we were doing, each one of those students felt like they were seen and felt like they were heard and that their stories mattered. And even to this day, I still get calls asking when I'm bringing him back. So I highly recommend him. He's been quite busy since he came to visit us at the Carver. In addition to sharing his talents around the country, he also devotes a lot of his time to working with youth in Houston. He's the coach for Metaphor, which is Houston's youth slam poetry team, who he took to Brave New Voices this year, also took them to the Texas Youth Poetry Slam where they won state. And they appeared alongside him when he was invited to participate in Houston's recent TEDx Talks. He traveled to the Individual World Poetry Slam this October, where he ranked 9th. And he recently was also nominated for Texas State Poet Laureate, who was one of the youngest nominees ever, I believe. And he recently concluded a tour of his work, which you're about to see an excerpt from, called Converse. This also happens to be his first time at NPN, and let me tell you, he's excited. For a year, all I've heard from him is NPN, 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 where can I go, how can I get there, who do I need to talk to? So please help me give a big NPN welcome to Emmanuel Liebing, also known as Outspoken B.
Thank you. Hi. That was a long intro. Are you ready?
Here we go. Alright. This is my roommate, and I just met her last night. And so we're going to, that sounds bad, but it's all good. It's all good, I promise. Art verse. Okay. So the name is an excerpt of Converse of How It Might Go, and could you, Primo, could you tell me a time when someone that you were close to kind of disappointed you? Could you share that for me?
Yeah, a moment. One moment in particular. I was 13 years old. My biological father, spent a fair amount of time with him. One day he left and he said, you know, I'm gonna holler at you in a week, and I never saw him again.
Wow. Could you share?
Yeah, I was recently disappointed by something that my ex-husband did in regards to my daughter. And my process of it was that I ended up more disappointed in myself for being disappointed. I felt that I should have been strong enough to rise above the disappointment and that I should have been able to deflect that hurt.
Wow. And so it doesn't seem like I'm not sharing. My story is when I was at undergrad at Prairie View A&M, and I met someone there who's now one of my best friends. He's a great friend of mine, and he's a musician. He's a musician. He's a pianist. He's also a singer. You know, I look back at it now. I was just hating on him because he could sing and I couldn't. But at the time, I had a really legit reason why I didn't like him. But those first 4 months, we really weren't that strong as friends. But then we wound up growing to be really close. And he made a bad decision. He was like, you know, I'm gonna go into the service. I'm not gonna come back to school next year. I'm gonna go into the service. And I'm a military brat. And I warned him, like, and I actually urged him, like, that's a really bad idea. Like, please don't do this. And you know, being that we didn't start off like on a great foot of friends, and honestly, like, who am I to him? That's how he kind of saw it. He wound up not listening, and he was on his own. Anyway, next semester happens, and I get a call on a Sunday from a mutual friend saying, Carrick is here. Like, let's kick it, let's drink, let's have some fun, like, come here, he's here. Like, I'm like, cool. So I dropped everything I was doing, and I went straight to my friend Ely's house. And there was Carrick right there, and he looked really tired and worn. Like, yeah, I went through a lot of different things. And so we wind up just talking and catching up. And he always had a bad habit of wanting to share new songs with people, but the songs he would share are like just at the bad time. So it's like scenario, a room full of men, and then he wants to serenade us. And none of us were interested at all whatsoever, right? So that time comes up, he's like, I have a new song. And all of us moaned and groaned at the same time, like, nah, we're good to see you. We'd rather you be here longer than kick you out. And what wound up happening is he just kept on pressuring it. So then I was like, man, what's the song? And he was like, all right, but it starts with a story. And the story was he had a dream where he was walking on I-10, if you know I-10, you're not walking on it. And he went under a bridge and he met this old man, and this homeless man, and he asked him how he got here. And the man responded, I tried to be everything I wanted to be. What's going on? I looked and searched as far as the eye can see. What's coming on? I've conquered many mountains, stood by the edge of the sea. What's that when you lost all love, self-pride, and dignity? And then he responded, Superman, don't save me, let me fall. Superman, don't save me, let me fall. Superman, don't save me. If mass falls, at 120 miles per hour, and you're faster than a speeding bullet, then essentially you catching me while I'm falling will do more harm than help. So Superman, don't save me. Let me fall. Let the wind massage my skin. Let gravity do its job, because I know for a man of your stature and responsibility, the request I'm asking of you is extremely hard, but sometimes as humans, we have to make mistakes. Sometimes as humans, we kind of have to hit brick walls. Sometimes as humans, we can be on top of the Empire State, arms stretched wide, believing that we can fly, but then that's when we are reminded to fall, because as humans, that's the only way we can learn to get up and rise. So Superman, don't save me, let me fall. Thank you.
Big round of applause for Outspoken Me. All right, at the end, it's lunchtime. What do we need to know about lunch, Vivian?
Oh, it's a box lunch today. You can pick them up in the next foyer. And it's for those of you who have a little yellow ticket. We have enough for those people who said, yeah, I want a lunch. You may not have something for people who didn't say it. And then take your lunch and enjoy the views. Thanks.